listening to The Vibe, and this is Travis J.
And Candace.
It's good for the culture.
Yo, what's going on, people? Welcome to The Vibe. Welcome back to The Vibe. This is Travis J.
And this is Candace.
And right now, we've got a special guest in the studio, you know. Legend in the studio, you know.
Jeez.
Big boy in the game right now, you know.
Yes.
Listen. Studio clap for Bushkin. MC Bushkin from Heartless crew. What's going on, brother?
Yo, man, I'm dead there. Can't hear myself, but I'm All good.
Man, it's nice to have you here, man.
No, man, blessings. Pleasure. No, I still can't hear myself, but it's all good.
I'm going to sort you out.
No, it's crazy, man. No, how you been, man?
Well, I'm good, you know. Gee, I'm always eye on life, me, you know.
Yeah,
always on a little vibe. So, I'm all the more better to be in the building.
That's it.
Stand on the beat, the heartbeat, and, you know. Mm-hmm.
Love that.
Love that. This is
the Heartless takeover. You understand? This is the Heartless vibe.
First show of the year. Heartless.
You know, you got to say it right. Heartless. You understand?
Nice.
Madness, man. You know, Bushkin is mad. I remember when I first met you, it was at the Comedy Roast. Listen, they had Bushkin come in as the roastie. All the comedians are there, lined up to roast Bushkin.
That's a brave move. But did you not? Were you not nervous? Or
I was a bit nervous, you know, until I got there.
Yeah.
And I had to put my match game on and this is my match face and say, yo, you know.
Listen,
poker face.
We get out there.
Yeah, of course.
We get out there. All these promoters of gas, they're like, boom, Travis, everyone's coming for you. So go out there on the offensive. Go cuss everybody, Bushkin, the other comedians.
Wow.
I've come out and I'm sending for everybody. Just not realizing that all these people in the audience are strong Bushkin fans, you know.
How did that go down, guys?
Listen,
were they not? No. Not here for it.
Bushkin came out the champion on that night, is what I was saying.
Wow.
Pull out the super soaker and sprayed people on stage with the water gun.
Yeah, I come prepared.
Came with props.
I'm prepared, you know. Me, I don't like to lose, you know. That's one thing about me. I don't like to lose nothing still. Nah,
that's a big look, man. But you know what? It's mad, though, because it's nice to have you here. Do you know what I'm saying? It's like when we look back on the history of the scene, do you know what I'm saying? Grime, garage as we know it, Heartless crew is like the foundation, cornerstone. Do you know what I mean? How does that make you feel?
Nice. It's man, feel good, still proud and stuff like that, and humbled. Mm. And as proud and as humble man feel, you know, there's still much more to do still, you know. So
yeah.
I mean, yeah, it's good, and it feels good, but you know, the work isn't finished yet, man. There's more to do still. So yeah, just on the next wave again.
Yeah, because the thing is that, like, when it comes to like speaking to pioneers of a certain type of scene, I always wonder, like, was it in your intentions to create a scene, or were you just kind of just going with the vibes at the time?
No, I wasn't. I never actually set out to create a scene. Definitely not. But what is, man, was always just different and always been a kind of innovator in a way.
Mm-hmm.
He's had a different style with the ends. And that's just kind of how it happened, man.
Yeah.
It was a natural, organic kind of thing, as they would say.
Yeah. Because I know, like, you know, when you look back, it's like Heartless crew, pays go, so solid. Yeah. You know, you mentioned those three sets. Do you know what I'm saying? What did you guys do that made you guys so different? Because you guys stood out, man. It's just pure good vibes with Heartless crew. You know what I mean?
I mean, you know what it was? Us sort of come from sound system. So a lot of people don't know that because we got popular in garage, but people don't know we had about 8 to 10 years of like building and being a sound system, you know, and going around playing at house parties,
okay,
bare record boxes, stringing up a sound system and all that kind of stuff, going through that whole motion. So
old school, proper stringing up your own
doing the proper groundwork, turning up with bare boxes at the end and not having to string down the sound and all them kind of thing when everyone's gone home. Like, man went through that hardship there, you know, and catching bus. Like, them times, certain times, we used to send Mo on the bus with the record and me and Fonty would walk home because we never had enough money. You know,
oh, jeez.
So, yeah, we went right through it still. So that kind of give us a different aspect. When we come into, first we were trying to be jungle MCs and DJs. That was the first scene that was popping.
Mm.
And jungle was airtight. We couldn't get into that scene. So when we got into garage, like, it was just, we just found it so easy. It was ridiculous. We was only now bringing one record box as opposed to like all our record boxes and not knowing, when you're a sound, you don't know what you're going to play, so you have to bring everything. When it's garage, it's just one drum box, so we just bring one record bag, and it's like the MCs weren't doing a lot, basically. So where we come from jungle, we're able to chat right away all the way through from the start to the finish of a record.
Yeah.
And we're like, wow, no one ain't really doing that. It's like, wow, this is just like, it's made it easy for us.
So yeah,
where we come from somewhere else and was different in garage, people followed what we done, so they may have not had the initial training what we had. So that's what I think made us different.
Okay, now
stand out from all the rest of them.
I'm with you, man. I mean, where did the name Heartless Crew come from? Because that sounds like the most gallest title that anyone could ever come up with.
Yeah. I made that name up in secondary school, you know, and it's like exactly that. Them time there, again, it's a sound system. All the sounds had, it was Kilimanjaro, Black Cat, Black Mafia was at the UK sound. King Status crystallized. Every sound had a wicked name. Them time, they were all about the wickedest name, basically. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, we had a couple names first. Destruction, we had Wicked Intention. And them names were right, but they sounded similar to what was around.
Yeah.
When I come with Heartless Crew back then, this is like early 90s, it was just like, wow, that just sounded mad. It was nothing madder than that. Even up to now, it still sounds sick. Like,
Yeah.
It's Heartless got a ring
Crew
to it, innit?
That's what I'm saying. It's like you hear Heartless Crew, you just know, boom.
Yeah, it means business. The name alone just says that, like, well, we're here for business.
Man, they play no games. Now, I got to ask, right? Now, I know you man used to go hard back in the day, especially when it came to the clashes.
Yeah.
Do you know what I'm saying? One clash that sticks out to me is when you guys went up against Pays You Go. Pays You Go at Destiny.
What happened? I got in there first prior to Fonty and Mo getting in there because it was Ram outside again.
Okay.
I've slipped in, you know, and I'm in there. And I'm
so you're just in there one man up?
I'm in there one up. You know, I'm round the back. I'm just chilling in this old and my own little vibe. Yeah.
Mm.
Boom. So, but I'm listening to them man on stage. They don't know I'm in there, obviously. And they're saying little too cheeky remarks. If you listen back to the actual set,
you can hear it. They're going in at you, man, already.
Oh, these men don't come soon. We're going to take their food and we're going to yam their. Yeah. If you listen to it, you can hear it. But it's not Chris Clear, but obviously, because I'm in there and I'm. We are preying the things I'm hearing. Oh, if these men are late, oh, they're scared, they don't want to turn up.
Yeah.
Promoter, you know what? We're going to take the next crew's money. Where?
Nah, that's wild.
Whatever, G.
Yeah.
But it's getting to the point now, my head's getting a bit hot. Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, boom. I run up there and touch on stage, you hit me? But it just so happened, as I've touched on stage, Pointy and Mo have come in as well, you understand?
Okay.
The kind of timing was perfect, God is good. And it's like, the thing's on there, you can hear it. I'm saying to myself, well, I'm up on stage, I'm just bubbling and making them feel my presence, you hit me? And Maxwell, he's giving me the mic. And then from, he's giving me the mic.
Game over. Oh, my God.
I actually even listened back recently, and your airman said, "Oh, you give me the mic, you idiot, kind of thing." Yeah, it's a mad team.
That was legendary, man. You know what I'm saying? Like, so you clashed with So Solid as well.
Yeah, man, we had to put them under as well, 6 feet, man.
You man put them so wait, your body's So Solid as well.
Yeah, we had to. Yeah,
nah, this is mad.
Put them underground as well. Still, you know, they pulled a fast one. You know, the man put on down a rave, and it was our radio station at the time, which was Freak FM.
Okay.
Against Delight FM and Heartless Be So Solid.
Okay.
But we weren't actually booked for the rave. They didn't book us. You understand?
Know, yeah.
Like an unofficial team. You know, and them time they were like, well, if we had a sound system mentally, if you want us to play as a clash, it's different money than if you just want us to play out.
Yeah, of course.
So anyway, they done their thing, promoting it. We had a different dance in the day, so we went to another dance, played out, and we've come there just to collect some peace. You know, so when we're in there again, we're on the top of the balcony, and there's a videotape for it. Now, put out the Mega Man has got the video. I know Mega's got it, you know. Mega, please, every interview I see,
release the video,
the
Mega.
Footage, Mega. So anyway, we're in there. Again, they don't know we're in there because we just come from another rave.
Okay.
We're already unofficially, everyone knows we're not turning up, you understand?
Yeah.
We're booked for it. So we're at the top of the balcony. We're watching down. And again, the man in my saying two little cheeky things and they're having little digs and this, that and the other. Bearing in mind, this is in Camden Palace, North London, you know. Mm-hmm. Ends, you hear me?
Mm-hmm.
So while we're up the top, people keep on coming up to us. Whoa, ain't you man going to let them say that? Why ain't you man going to clash? Ain't you man going up there? And I was like, cool. That time we all come out with our girls as well, you know. So every man was with gal as well. You know?
You're feeling that pressure now.
So we're like, okay, we're just kind of chilling, like, you understand? And the girls are kind of looking at us. They're not saying that, but you know, girl give you a little
they know.
Look like,
yeah.
Like, you man are going
to
go
let
out,
man, like, you can't let my say
like, well, yeah, me. So anyway, it's getting to the point, and then I think word must have got to these guys as well that were actually in the building, because on the videotape I saw the video once, yeah, and it's like someone goes on the stage and it's like they're all in the row on the stage, and it's like whispers, Chinese whispers. So a man says to the first man, like, raw, Heartless are in the building. Yeah, so obviously I don't know exactly what they said, but it's like, and then you see the man look up.
Okay.
And it passed on to the next man, and then so they all
start looking slowly.
Yeah, start looking up, yeah, me. So anyway, I don't know who said it, might Fonty or man said, well, get the records, man, because these men are taking the biscuit now. And man went and got the record out of the car, yeah? Because we didn't even come to clash.
Yeah.
We come back in with the records and gone up there. And yeah, same thing, Woof Buff Beth and...
Jeez.
It's mad, isn't it?
Say, Woof Buff Beth.
Woof Buff Beth.
Yeah. Remember, it's North London as well, you know? So yeah. Really...
They get into the thing.
Full of themselves, you know? The man come above their station and try the thing. You can't do that, man.
How do you feel about the Red Bull culture clash? You know what I'm saying? Because you know clashing from, you know what I mean, wiring up at parties, yeah. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. But then, you know, Red Bull culture clash, what does it look like to you? How do you feel about it?
I mean, again, it's the same old story, you understand? This is, we know where we are and where we live and what the story is, you understand? Mm. So, the people in, let's just say, power, position of power, they take the essence. They always know how to dip in and take our essence out.
That's it.
And then spin it back and give it back to us and
try to commercialize it.
Yeah, commercialize it and make it like, wow, this is, they've done it or it's their thing, you understand? And they just try and rub away the history, you understand? But the history and the foundation. That's why it's good to be doing these shows and questions that get asked, because people have to know the foundation and where it actually comes from and it stems from, because these people have to rub it out and rewrite it, so to speak, you understand? It's not really about that, yeah?
But don't you think that Red Bull Culture Clash is good for traction? Because the amount of people that wouldn't have known about a clashing culture and the sound systems and so on, Red Bull Culture Clash is almost that middleman where everyone can tap into it. My parents watched it.
Yeah.
I watched it. It's not like defined by color, age or anything. If you looked at the audience, it's not who you think would be in the audience.
Yes.
You see what I mean? Yes, it's completely. Yes, complete, so is that not a positive spin on the whole?
That is very positive, you understand? I can't knock them in that respect. Very positive. I mean, again, and it's another show and another deeper conversation.
Mm-hmm.
Because on the face of it, that is very positive. But then you've got the thing is like, if someone else was trying to do this thing and got the actual people who were really knew about this thing, would it run like that? Would they be able to run it like that? You know?
Yeah.
That's, oh, I see what you're saying. Would you be able to take it from the original place to that type of scale?
Yeah, would the original people be able to do this? You understand? Really and truly, you understand? And many have tried, you understand? And hopefully these things will change. And maybe by Red Bull doing it, it kind of...
Set pace,
and you understand? But then again, this is the funny thing because... Yeah, it's another conversation.
Anyway. Yeah, no, I feel you.
We have to reason about it. No, we want to get too deep in the mix.
I see what you're saying. Nah, you know, it's funny, man. It's like, I remember being young and taping Heartless Crew sets just so I can learn the words for the next day at school. You know what I'm saying? Nah, because you look at things now, it's like, you know, Grime's obviously leading the way. But yeah, you guys are like the corners. I mean, what do you think of Grime today?
Yeah, man, I like it, you know. I like Grime today. I like the UK scene in general, to be honest with you. I like where it's at and where it's got to.
Yeah.
I mean, Grime, I love it, and I love the energy. My one kind of... gripe in a way would be the kind of got a negative spin in a way, and not in the media, I'm saying just the artists and the subject matters.
Okay, you understand? Okay.
So that's the one thing, you
talking about, like, the lyrical content,
yeah, and yeah, just the kind of persona and the attitude of it, you understand? It's got a little slight negative spin to it, you understand? But I mean, that again can be changed, you understand? And again, it's one thing talking about it, but because I feel strongly about it, it's something that I would actually try and, you understand, again, help to change. And you understand?
I hear you. I mean, what do you think that, you know, why do you think that's a problem that some of the lyrics are the way they are? Because a lot of these guys will defend and say, I'm just telling my story.
Yeah, that's right. You know what I'm saying? And that's what I'm saying. And that's the part what I would say. Yeah, it's all good to tell the story because we've come from somewhere, but where are you going? You understand? Where are you at? Are you at the same place where the story you're telling, are you at the same place?
It's a very good point.
Right now, even if you are, where are you going? Because can you tell that story as well? And can it be a big
thing? That's right. Props. Yeah. Yeah, true.
So again, but like I said, it's these stuff that man know, and it's like, who knows better does better in those settings, you understand? So again, my man doing these things and, you understand, putting out tunes like this, you understand, with a little vibe and a message in it, you understand, then hopefully people can follow suit. You know what is with Grime as well? Grime, to me, Heartless Crew, coming from a sound system, we covered all the spectrums of like music and all the angles, which is what a sound does. So they'll play the slow stuff, they even play pop, they play what's current, they play the old, they play the new, you understand? Us that used to do this, and in Garage in particular, so we had our ladies selection, you understand? We played the ladies, we played the hype section, and we had a kind of almost rude boy section, you understand?
Mm.
And we had the lyrics, the girly lyrics to go along with that. The Grime seemed to, for what I understand, what kind of took the gully section and just ran with that and left the other sections.
I see what you're saying. You know what? This is a major interview right now with Bushkin. Lock in. If you've got any questions, tweet us at TheBeat1036. Pressure on Bushkin right now.
We are indeed.
We've got some tweets that's just coming through.
We do. Right. So we've got one from Big Man Lucian. And he says, how is your relationship with Fonty and Mo? He says, I've still got the cassette tapes of you guys from 1999.
Mad.
I'm through it back.
Big up, big man. Yeah, man, you don't know. The relationship's good, you know. I'm not going to lie, we went through a little rocky period, but like, we've grown up literally like brothers, man. Trust me, sir. No matter, you know, our family says, you know, Sam, you can war and argue and.
That's it.
Yeah, cuss each other out and all that. So it didn't actually get that bad, you know, Sam. But, I mean, yeah, it was sticky at a time, you know, Sam. But yeah, man, the love conquers all, you understand? And time is the biggest healer, you get me?
That's
so the relationship right now is great still. Even when it was sticky, you know, you couldn't say a thing to me about more fun, you know, shut your box, you understand? So, yeah, so even when it was sticky, you understand? The love was there, but yeah, you know, all it is, we was around each other so long, we grew up in each other's pockets, so to speak. We've been in Amsterdam, we've shared each other's socks, we've all three of us stayed in one room, you understand, we're top and tailed, you understand, like, so the transition going from that to men, you understand, and changing that, each of us grew, you understand, and kind of different ideologies, and, I mean, Heartless Crew was our common ground, and we all had a different idea at one time of how it should go, and that was the issue, you understand? It wasn't really an issue about the friendship or brothers, it was more an issue of the kind of the business and the direction that we thought we should take it in at the time.
I get you. Is that what caused the split?
That's what caused the split, because again, it was me again, I had the street breaks at one time, you know, and I said, to be honest with you, I value the man's love and friendship more than the business,
you understand?
So I said, you know what, let me just ease back, we call it a day for now, you understand?
No, that's important, man. It's important to know that's how it went.
That's how it went. It's just straight real, real to real, you get me? But like I said, the love is the love, man, and the man them always be my brothers. And you know what is, again, people don't know, this is way back in the days, we all got tattoos, you understand? So we've all got three tattoos, we've all got a tattoo on each of our backs, you understand? Close to God, brothers for life, never give up, Heartless Crew.
You all have that tattoo on your
all
back?
All of us have the tattoo, you understand? Exact same tattoo. I mean, mine was a bit different, being the extrovert, I got mine in red. But, I mean,
extrovert.
Yeah, exactly. But yeah, we've all got the same tattoo with the same writing. So no matter what way or whatever, you understand? The love is there, you understand? It's on our back, you understand? And that's why we got it. To make us, in a way, it was our way of being blood brothers.
I get you.
Again, blood brothers is the old school thing. People might not know what it is, but it's like when you cut each other and you share each other's blood. You understand? And your blood brothers.
That's mad. That's like them Western films where, you know, they slice their
literally
hand and
literally, it's
the handshake.
thumb on thumb. Yeah. So. We've also got another question from Wavy Webb, who's asked, where did you get your HLC tattoo? He said it looks sick, and can you give him a shout out?
Okay. Yo, Wavy Webb, big up, my brother. And again, we all got the tattoos originally in North London, Holloway. That's like the area we grew up in. You understand? Some kind of backstreet tattoo shop, to be honest. You understand? But this is way before tattoos was even popular. But I had mine redone, to be honest with you. So mine now is actually different.
You had a little touch up.
Yes, yeah.
Being an extrovert.
Yeah.
Mine into the 260s and everything there. Yeah, me, sir. I got mine done by a guy called Atom, up in Croydon, basically. Follow me on Twitter, and I'm gonna tag you into a thing with him, because he done my thing mad. Now my one's gone off through the roof. Yeah, man, like... they look like a baby tattoo now, what them man there got. So, yeah.
No. So savage.
You know what I'm saying? You know, I want to ask, like, because I know that, you know, you mentioned how you guys are cool, you and Heartless and the other guys, and everybody's kind of reconciled. I think reconciliation is good to hear about. Do you know what I'm saying? Because like, I know that there was a time where you and Megaman had a situation.
Yes.
Do you know what I'm saying? And now, obviously, present day, you guys are, you know, you got the relationship is back to a good place.
Yeah.
But, you know what I'm saying? What happened there?
Again, we've had a few little ones. And I mean, I think me and Megaman are two very similar characters. We're both headstrong, and we're both very sure of ourselves, you understand?
Yeah.
What the main incident what you might be talking about was in Aiya Napa, and Megaman put us on a flyer again. My head's hot for things like this. I don't like it, you get me? And he put us on a flyer without booking us, and the rave was jammed. So that man confronted him, and it was one of them little things, yeah, you understand? And again, I'll give it to Megaman, because Mega's a man from far. I've always rated and respected what he's done and liked him. But again, I ain't taking no check when it comes to certain things as well. And he's probably the same. So it was like almost a standoff, you understand? And boom, boom. It never come to any form of blows or whatever, because we've got both of us had good people around us. We're kind of easing things off. But me, if I'm in the right, which I was in this situation, I ain't giving up the goals. That's how I am at first. I ain't about being wrong and strong, but you know what?
When you're right,
out.
You know.
Yeah, you're doing us out now, and I'm going to go all the way to the end sign and whatever. So, but it was a little situation, but it got resolved. And again, like I said, I think we've both got a mutual respect for each other, you understand? Mm-hmm. We're both two leaders in the industry, you understand? I'm sure you would say the same for me. So I always big him up and rate him like that. And yeah, man, the love is there. And ultimately, unity is strength, you understand? Mm-hmm. We always do talk, and we've done little bits and bobs together. We've actually got to do a lot more, because we can actually, like, he's been from South London, I'm from North as well. We can actually do a lot if we unite more better. Unity is always strength, man. That's where the power really lies.
That's the truth, man. That's the truth. You know what I mean? Pastor Bushkin is in service. Amen.
Pastor Bushkin.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Church.
Now, I saw with an interview with Wiley, right? He said that Heartless and you, you know, you specifically responsible for Grime. You know, it kind of started with you guys.
Yeah.
How do you feel about that?
He's not wrong. And you know what is, again, prior to this time, I've always kind of, again, I'm not a man to too much try and blow my own trumpet and stuff like that. My mum always said, yeah, keep your feet on your ground and, you understand?
Mm-hmm.
Little things like this I've been brought up with, you understand? I was actually brought up in the church, you understand? In the Seventh-day Adventist church, funny enough, you understand? So, and I'm around my grand a lot, so these people always keep me, my feet on the ground. Self-praise is no praise, and a lot of these things, but
self-praise is no praise. Yeah, gotta quote that and tweet that.
All these lines, I grew up with them, so, so, I mean, up until this point, I've never really gone out and
said something like that.
Yeah, we started crying, but I mean, it is what it is, and I can't hide the truth. We didn't actually start it. We didn't name it, you understand?
Mm.
But we started that move there. We come into garage and change garage. And what we was doing in garage wasn't garage. It wasn't really accepted by the garage people.
Right, right.
You understand? And it wasn't actually garage. We did change it. We, like I said, we started to chat all those. What grime is to me, the essence of grime is the energy, you understand? Mm. And grime is more about the MCs as opposed to the DJ. The garage scene was more about the music. Grime scene is more about the MCs and the energy.
Mm.
And that's what we bring to garage. We was like the crew, we had two MCs, you understand? So it made Fonty was now the man behind the music, and the focus was on myself and Mighty Mo.
Okay.
Understand? Which is the MCs, which is the same thing in grime.
What, yeah.
You understand? So that's straight transparent.
I see what you're saying.
And then also the energy we brought to garage wasn't actually there before. Mans were behind and talking bits and pieces on the music in the gaps. We came and started chatting all over the music, you understand? And that forced producers to change the music to allow this, you understand? So again, we changed that. And then the last thing is what we done, we was up front of the stage jumping up and wheeling up tunes. Now again, in garage,
okay,
no one was wheeling tunes. There was no wheel ups in garage like that, especially the way we're doing. But remember, we've come from Sound System.
That's right.
Sound Splash thing where tunes get wheeled up.
Mm-hmm.
We're in garage, we were like the first people to chatter four bars and then the tune get wheeled up and the place go mad.
Okay.
Which is the essence of grime.
That's right.
Now, so when I'm saying we started it, these are stuff we started and no one wasn't doing this. And if someone, correct me if I'm wrong, if there was people doing this, someone please correct me, but I'm here and I'm saying it like, right, there weren't. We were the first crew in garage.
Jeez.
Yeah.
Jeez.
So
this is, I'll call you Mr. Grime from now on, bruv.
It's raps.
Nah, this is major, man. Do you know what? We got Mc Bushkin live in the studio right now. Keep your tweets coming in. Wiley's here. He's going to answer your question. Tweet us at the beat 1036 FM. It's mad.
Yeah.
You know what's mad is, like, you know, Heartless was just crazy successful, right? Now, you guys had a major deal back then.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Especially for that time. Was there, like, ever a time, now that money's in the equation, like proper money, did that ever influence or change the way you guys moved or operated your business?
What, back then?
Yeah.
Yeah, it did change it in a major way. I mean, we was always making money and we had the kind of entrepreneur vibe. So even before we got signed up, and we was like making some really good money, you understand? And then when we got signed up, we got a hell of a load of money. But the funny thing is, with the money came a pressure, and that is really where the beginning of the end started, to be honest with you. That was like the original crux, because we got the money, but we went with the label that gave us the most money and the least control.
Right.
And there was a label at the time who was offering less money but was willing to give us the control, and they understood. So that was a label that Dizzy Rascal actually signed with, and he went on to have the success with his EXO Recordings at the time.
Okay.
We went with the label, being young and being, again, we was very competent in ourselves, and you understand, again, even slightly maybe arrogant even at the end
of
the time, the end, everything's running, we've pretty much done it ourselves, making loads of money ourselves, had our own office, you understand, and with our own entity in a way. So we thought, yeah, we deserve to get the most money and stuff like that, and we're gonna be able to do what we can do, you understand? And it didn't actually work out like that. So with that money there came a headache with the record label, and it put a kind of dampener on our vibe in a way, you understand?
Mm.
It kind of started to change things.
Did it change things by way of your relationship with each other, or just change things about what your plans were for the Heartless crew?
Probably the relationship with each other.
Okay.
Because what it was, I can't actually produce music. Mo can produce a bit. In fact, out of the three of us, I'm the least musical.
Okay. Yeah?
Fonty is the most musical out of the three of us. So, I mean, it wasn't necessarily the money in itself, but it was the pressure that came, because now we had to make an album. We'd never made an album before.
Mm.
You understand? Okay. So now it's like, well, we have to make an album by a certain time, you understand?
Mm.
And like, that put a whole heap of pressure on Fonty. Like, my strength was the business side.
Yeah.
You understand? So I'd always set up the office. And it was a big issue between myself and Fonty, basically. He was the two original members of the Heartless crew, Mo came later. So, like, I'm more entrepreneurial and Fonty's more musical, which is why the thing worked really well.
That's right, yeah, the balance.
The balance. So I set up an office, and the end time we had an office running and stuff like that. And Fonty was now in the studio. We bought a studio, and Fonty was in the studio making the music. But Fonty's gripe, and I mean, now I'm older, I kind of understand it, although we still have a laugh about it and we still stick to our guns. Fonty was saying, listen, forget the office stuff. Come and make the music, because this is what's going to make us the real money.
Mm.
But because we were making so much money in the office, I'm saying, well, we're making our money. You just make the music, mm-hmm. and then we do the office. But Fonty's saying, well, I need you in the studio, bring the vibes. And I'm saying, well, just make the vibes. When man come,
okay.
put the cherry on the top, which yeah. is what I knew.
Did you guys have like mentors or people that were guiding you? Because to run an office of any size or whatever, that's quite a big deal in itself, let alone a studio as well.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And obviously the working dynamic between you. So was there people in place that were like sort of guiding you or giving you outlines or advising you?
Not really, but what it is, I would... In fact, one thing I got to fall back quickly, because at the end of the last thing, I forgot to big Wiley up, you know, because as much as man started the thing, you know, Wiley took it to the next level and pioneered it, you know, so I never can ever take away what he's done. So I got to big up Wiley.
Mm. Yeah.
100, you get me? And then in this talk here, there was a man called Swift. He was the man who set a Mission FM, basically. He was the bigger boy in my area, basically.
Mm.
Okay.
And he was doing other bits and bobs first, which I was doing first, and he saw me doing other bits and bobs and took me and my brethren up, and we was doing bits and bobs all together for him, basically, like that. But then he saw we had an interest in music, and he caught the Heartless wave, and he kind of pulled me to a side, and he was like my mentor for a good few years. Like, but yeah. I always bring him up and I say, when I bust Lian San billionaire business, I'm coming and just dropping some meals on him, because yes, and he taught me a lot.
Mm.
He was the first man to make me drive big convertible BM, mm-hmm. make me go and pick up girl in the BM. Jeez. And make me feel like a dad. Talk to me, make me make certain phone calls. Bush, can you do this? Phone these people. And I'm like, oh, Swifty, man. He said, no, phone them, cancel the flyers. We don't want the flyers anymore. So tell them we don't want the flyers. And I'd have to phone. And you understand? He just put me.
You're learning the ropes.
Learning
yeah.
the business, you understand? And again, we had office. This is way before Brick Lane was popular. We all had office in Brick Lane. He paid one half and us three paid the other half. Listen, sir, I did learn a lot of stuff from him, but
yeah.
also I had the vibe as well, you get me?
Yeah,
yeah, big up Swifty, 110%.
Nice.
It's major. Now, you've been in the game for a very long time, do you know what I'm saying? And even now, you mention Bushkin to anybody, people know straight away. There's mm-hmm. no thinking back, there's no throwback, it's still today, you understand? What advice do you have for any young up-and-coming artists in the game?
The main thing I always say to people, you have to know yourself. Like 100%, it sounds easy, you understand, but that's the main thing. It's not just in the music, that's just in life in general.
Mm.
You really have to know yourself, you understand, know your what you'd accept, have some, know your integrity, you understand, have some integrity, know what you're willing to accept and what you're willing to do, and you understand what you're willing to compromise and what you're not willing to compromise. That would be a very, very important thing, and especially in the music industry, where it's like people can spin you and gash you up and rub you up, and you understand, and before you know it, you was never taking drugs, and now you're taking drugs because of the pressure and stuff. Mm-hmm. There's so many different things, so
yeah,
you really have to know yourself, you understand, and be of a strong mind, a sound mind, and you understand, that's the main thing. And me, what's been my rock and cornerstone, I'm always at my grand's, you understand, every week I'm
at my big up grandma.
Yeah, love my grandma and my family, you understand, it's amazing. So I'm there, my kids are there, my dad's there more time, my aunties are there, my granddaughters, you understand. So it's like my grand is actually my kid's great grand, you understand. So it's mad to have the whole
generation
yes, right.
in one out. But what it is for me as much as I'm on the road, Bushkin and hype and this and that, when I go to the house, it's a safe haven. It's back to basics. My normal name.
That's
and it's
it.
Like, wow, do this, do that, put the bin.
Take the bins out.
Normal things. Text when you get home. I'm like, grandma, I'm a big man. Like,
yeah,
really?
Yeah,
it's the deep thing that keep man grounded.
It's true.
I love that.
That's important.
Man can't spin me out of the road like, wow, this, that, and ever. Yeah.
Bruv, it's been a pleasure having you on the show today.
Nah, man,
your proper cornerstone, legendary status in the game, man. So it's an honor to have this chance to chat to you today.
Thank you for having me, man. It's been a pleasure, man. Yeah, the pleasure's all mine, man. Thanking you very much.
Wicked.
So how can everyone keep in touch with you? It's your socials?
Yeah, of course, man. Yeah, man, link me back on Snapchat. I'm on this Snapchat hype right now, you know, man.
Love it, love it.
Ricky Black, which is spelled RikiBlac. Black without a K. So yeah, link me up on the Snapchat, and then I'm on Twitter and Instagram as Mc Bushkin, and I'm on Facebook also as Ricky Black. I can't actually add any more people, but I can communicate.
Mr.
and
popular
show, and yeah, my Ricky reason, and yeah, boom boom. Yeah, me, so that's Ricky Black as well. RikiBlac.
Why Ricky Black?
That's my name.
Is that you? That's okay. The real him. okay.
Yeah.
Cool. Amazing. Yeah. Well, thank you very much for blessing the vibe. You're the first guest of 2017.
That's it.
Love it, man.
That's
set
it.
Pace.
The king is here.
Yeah. Saying nothing.
Oh,
my ting. Big respect, bro.
Love,
into the vibe, and this is Travis J.
And Candace.
It's good for the culture.